So if I ask you to think about space, what comes to mind? Maybe it was the moon landing in 1969.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Or maybe it was the Challenger mission in 1986.
Liftoff from the 25th space shuttle mission, and it has cleared the tower.
Or maybe it's SpaceX, which is even more recent, and how they launched a convertible into space. But what if I ask you to think about who comes to mind? Maybe you think Elon Musk, the CEO of SpaceX, and the chief designer behind it. Or maybe you think of Neil deGrasse Tyson, the very famous astrophysicist and communicator of astronomy. And I'm guessing lots of you thought about astronauts. Names like Neil Armstrong, first person to set foot on the moon, or Buzz Aldrin, or maybe Sally Ride, Kalpana Chawla, or Gion Bluford Jr. There are plenty of great explorers to learn about and to learn from. The 20th century is characterized by lots of people who desired to leave the boundaries of Earth. On December 17, 1903, two American aviation pioneers named Wilbur and Orville Wright made the first controlled sustained flight in an aircraft that they invented. Their flight lasted only 12 seconds, and it traveled only 120 feet, but they flew! Can you believe that it was less than 70 years later that NASA actually landed a man on the moon? Think about all the science and discovery that happened in those 70 years. During that time, America and Russia also had a major conflict called the space race, in which each one was trying to be the first country to land a man on the moon. Today, we see an era of much better cooperation. A perfect example of that is the International Space Station, which houses astronauts from all over the world. While we've been able to put a human on the moon, we still haven't been able to put a human on another planet. Mars, which is our closest neighbor, we only put the first rover down on July 7th, 2003. And there have been 56 missions to Mars, but only 26 of them have been successful. That should tell you how difficult it actually is to send missions to Mars. So what factors do you think that scientists have to deal with in overcoming these challenges just to get to Mars? First, let's take a look at some of the myths of Mars. Many people think that Mars is bigger or the same size as Earth. Actually, it's smaller, just under half the size of Earth. Mars is also nicknamed the Red Planet because of its rusty iron makeup in the ground. There are also signs of ancient flooding in Mars, but now we only find water in icy dirt and very thin clouds. Compare that to Earth, which has 70% of its surface covered in water. Mars has a very thin atmosphere made up of carbon dioxide, nitrogen, and argon. Notice there's no oxygen there. The atmosphere is 100 times thinner than Earth's atmosphere. Mars also has different seasons and weather. The temperature there can range from minus 220 degrees, that's really cold, in the wintertime, to 70 degrees Fahrenheit near the equator during the summer. But even in the summer, temperatures at night can plummet to minus 100 degrees Fahrenheit. So obviously scientists are eager to know if Mars was able to support life in the past, if it can in the present, or if it will be able to in the future. And if Mars could support life, what would that look like? Would it be the same kind of aliens you see in the movies? Probably not. But the characteristics of the planet do help determine what the organism will look like. For example, Mars is very cold. So what would that mean for the organism? Well, maybe they would need to have thick skin or a lot of fur to help them stay warm for those very cold temperatures. For example, let's take a look at an organism here on Earth. an Arctic rabbit survives very well in the Arctic or the cold parts of the Earth because it blends in well. It's a white rabbit. But if you took that white rabbit and put it, say, in the Amazon jungle, where everything is green, it would stick out very clearly and probably wouldn't survive. So how can these examples relate to an alien on Mars? What characteristics would help an alien on Mars? What kind of adaptations would an organism need to make to be able to survive on Mars? These are all questions that you need to take a minute and think critically about. So, with everything that we've been talking about on Mars, who's ready to go?
I am.
Well, not yet. Before we go, we have some things that we need to consider, like food, water, where are we gonna live? Those are all really important things that we need. But also, we have to ask other questions. How are we gonna get it there? How are we gonna build it once it's there? How are we gonna store it? These are all questions we need to consider when we colonize Mars. Think about whether there's anything on Mars that you can use to help you survive. For example, Mars has a very active weather system. Maybe that would help you with the energy problem. You could harness wind energy or solar energy. Or maybe there's something else you can use. What about things like oil and gasoline? Would they be there? Or could you make them out of some elements that are found on Mars? Okay, I know it's a lot to consider, but just like the name of the Mars rover in 2012, curiosity can lead you to a lot of exciting discoveries.
To download the free lesson plans to be used with this program, visit us online at wqed.org/SOS. To request a hard copy of the lesson plans, please contact your local school district. Funding for this program is provided by the Pennsylvania Department of Education for Learning at Home.